Altruism. Altruism is the principle and moral practice of concern for happiness of other human beings than or animals, resulting in a quality of life both material and spiritual. It is a traditional virtue in many cultures and a core aspect of various religious traditions and secular worldviews, though the concept of others toward whom concern should be directed can vary among cultures and religions. In Hindu, Sanatana Dharma, whose philosophy is inclusive, i.e. includes, and welcomes everybody, where the dictum Vasudaiva Kutumbakam, the world is one family, is in force, always, others means everyone, unconditionally. In an extreme case, altruism may become a synonym of selflessness, which is the opposite of selfishness. In a common way of living, it doesn't deny the singular nature of the subject, but realizes the traits of the individual personality in relation to the others, with a true, direct and personal interaction with each of them. It is focusing both on a single person and the whole community. In a, not only, Christian practice, it is the law of love directo the ego and his neighbor. The word altruism was coined by the French philosopher Auguste Comte in French, as altruisme, for an antonym of egoism. He derived it from the Italian altrui, which in turn was derived from Latin altri, meaning other people or somebody else. Altruism in biological observations in field populations of the day organisms is an individual performing an action which is at a cost to themselves, for example, pleasure and quality of life, time, probability of survival or reproduction, but benefits, either directly or indirectly, another third-party individual, without the expectation of reciprocity or compensation for that action. Steinberg suggests a definition for altruism in the clinical setting, that is intentional and voluntary actions that aim to enhance the welfare of another person in the absence of any quid pro quo external rewards. Altruism can be distinguished from feelings of loyalty, in that whilst the latter is predicated upon social relationships, altruism does not consider relationships. Much debate exists as to whether true altruism is possible in human psychology. The theory of psychological egoism suggests that no act of sharing, helping or sacrificing can be described as truly altruistic, as the actor may receive an intrinsic reward in the form of personal gratification. The validity of this argument depends on whether intrinsic rewards qualify as benefits. The term altruism may also refer to an ethical doctrine that claims that individuals are morally obliged to benefit others. Used in this sense, it is usually contrasted with egoism, which claims individuals are morally obligated to serve themselves first. The concept has a long history in philosophical and ethical thought. The term was originally coined in the 19th century by the founding sociologist and philosopher of science, Auguste Comte, and has become a major topic for psychologists, especially evolutionary psychology researchers, evolutionary biologists, and ethologists. Whilst ideas about altruism from one field can affect the other fields, the different methods and focuses of these fields always lead to different perspectives on altruism. In simple terms, altruism is caring about the welfare of other people and acting to help them. Marcel Mauss's book The Gift contains a passage called Note on Alms. This note describes the evolution of the notion of alms, and by extension of altruism, from the notion of sacrifice. In it, he writes, alms are the fruits of a moral notion of the gift and of fortune on the one hand, and of a notion of sacrifice, on the other. Generosity is an obligation, because nemesis avenged the poor and the gods for the superabundance of happiness and wealth of certain people who should rid themselves of it. This is the ancient morality of the gift, which has become a principle of justice. The gods and the spirits accept that the share of wealth and happiness that has been offered to them and had been hitherto destroyed in useless sacrifices should serve the poor and children. In the science of ethology, the study of animal behavior, and more generally in the study of social evolution, altruism refers to behavior by an individual that increases the fitness of another individual while decreasing the fitness of the actor. In evolutionary psychology, this may be applied to a wide range of human behaviors such as charity, emergency aid, help to coalition partners, tipping, courtship gifts, production of public goods, and environmentalism. Theories of apparently altruistic behavior were accelerated by the need to produce theories compatible with evolutionary origins. Two related strands of research on altruism have emerged from traditional evolutionary analyses and from evolutionary game theory, a mathematical model and analysis of behavioral strategies. Some of the proposed mechanisms are Such explanations do not imply that humans are always consciously calculating how to increase their inclusive fitness when they are doing altruistic acts. Instead, evolution has shaped psychological mechanisms, such as emotions, that promote altruistic behaviors. Every single instance of altruistic behavior need not always increase inclusive fitness. Altruistic behaviors would have been selected for if such behaviors on average increased inclusive fitness in the ancestral environment. This need not imply that on average 50% or more of altruistic acts were beneficial for the altruist in the ancestral environment. If the benefits from helping the right person were very high, it would be beneficial to err on the side of caution and usually be altruistic even if in most cases there were no benefits. The benefits for the altruist may be increased and the costs reduced by being more altruistic towards certain groups. Research has found that people are more altruistic to kin than to no kin, to friends than to strangers, to those attractive than to those unattractive, to non-competitors than to competitors, and to members in groups than to members off out-group. The study of altruism was the initial impetus behind George R. Price's development of the Price equation, which is a mathematical equation used to study genetic evolution. An interesting example of altruism is found in the cellular slime molds, such as dictyostelium mucoroids. These protists live as individual amoebae until starved, at which point they aggregate and form a multicellular fruiting body in which some cells sacrifice themselves to promote the survival of other cells in the fruiting body. Selective investment theory proposes that close social bonds, and associated emotional, cognitive, and neurohormonal mechanisms, evolved in order to facilitate long-term, high-cost altruism between those closely depending on one another for survival and reproductive success. Such cooperative behaviors have sometimes been seen as arguments for left-wing politics, such by the Russian zoologist and anarchist Peter Kropotkin in his 1902 book and Peter Singer in his book A Darwinian Left. Jorge Mal and Jordan Grafman, neuroscientists at the National Institutes of Health and Labstor Hospital Network, JM, provided the first evidence for the neural basis of altruistic giving in normal healthy volunteers, using functional magnetic resonance imaging. In their research, published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences USA in October 2006, they showed that both pure monetary rewards and charitable donations activated the mesolimbic reward pathway, a primitive part of the brain that usually responds to food and sex. However, when volunteers generously placed the interests of others before their own by making charitable donations, another brain circuit was selectively activated, the subgenual cortex/septal region. These structures are intimately related to social attachment and bonding in other species. Altruism, the experiment suggested, was not a superior moral faculty that suppresses basic selfish urges but rather was basic to the brain, hardwired and pleasurable. One brain region, the subgenual anterior cingulate cortex/basal forebrain, contributes to learning altruistic behavior, especially in those with trait empathy. The same study has shown a connection between giving to charity and the promotion of social bonding. In fact, in an experiment published in March 2007 at the University of Southern California, neuroscientist Antonio R. Damasio and his colleagues showed that subjects with damage to the ventromedial prefrontal cortex lack the ability to empathically feel their way to moral answers, and that when confronted with moral dilemmas, these brain-damaged patients coldly came up with and justifies the means answers, leading Damasio to conclude that the point was not that they reached immoral conclusions, but that when they were confronted by a difficult issue, in this case as whether to shoot down a passenger plane hijacked by terrorists before it hits a major city, these patients appear to reach decisions without the anguish that afflicts those with normally functioning brains. According to Adrian Rain, a clinical neuroscientist also at the University of Southern California, one of this study's implications is that society may have to rethink how it judges immoral people. Psychopaths often feel no empathy or remorse. Without that awareness, people relying exclusively on reasoning seem to find it harder to sort their way through moral thickets. Does that mean they should be held to different standards of accountability? In another study, in the 1990s, Dr. Bill Harbaugh, a University of Oregon economist, concluded people are motivated to give for reasons of personal prestige, and in a similar fMRI-SCANner test in 2007 with his psychologist colleague Dr. Ulrich Mayer, reached the same conclusions of Jorge Mal and Jordan Grafman about giving to charity, although they were able to divide the study group into two groups, egoists and altruists. One of their discoveries was that, though rarely, even some of the considered egoists sometimes gave more than expected because that would help others, leading to the conclusion that there are other factors in cause and charity, such as a person's environment and values. The International Encyclopedia of the Social Sciences defines psychological altruism as a motivational state with the goal of increasing another's welfare. Psychological altruism is contrasted with psychological egoism, which refers to the motivation to increase one's own welfare. There has been some debate on whether or not humans are truly capable of psychological altruism. Some definitions specify a self-sacrificial nature to altruism and a lack of external rewards for altruistic behaviors. However, because altruism ultimately benefits the self in many cases, the selflessness of altruistic acts is brought to question. The social exchange theory postulates that altruism only exists when benefits to the self outweigh costs to the self. Daniel Batson is a psychologist who examined this question and argues against the social exchange theory. He identified four major motives for altruism: altruism to ultimately benefit the self, egoism to ultimately benefit the other person, altruism to benefit a group, collectivism, or to uphold a moral principle, principlism. Altruism that ultimately serves selfish gains is thus differentiated from selfless altruism, but the general conclusion has been that empathy-induced altruism can be genuinely selfless. The empathy-altruism hypothesis basically states that psychological altruism does exist and is evoked by the empathic desire to help someone who is suffering. Feelings of empathic concern are contrasted with feelings of personal distress, which compel people to reduce their own unpleasant emotions. People with empathic concern help others in distress even when exposure to the situation could be easily avoided, whereas those lacking in empathic concern avoid helping unless it is difficult or impossible to avoid exposure to another's suffering. Helping behavior is seen in humans at about 2 years old, when a toddler is capable of understanding subtle emotional cues. In psychological research on altruism, studies often observe altruism as demonstrated through prosocial behaviors such as helping, comforting, sharing, cooperation, philanthropy, and community service. Research has found that people are most likely to help if they recognize that a person is in need and feel personal responsibility for reducing the person's distress. Research also suggests that the number of bystanders witnessing distress or suffering affects the likelihood of helping, the bystander effect. Greater numbers of bystanders decrease individual feelings of responsibility. However, a witness with a high level of empathic concern is likely to assume personal responsibility entirely regardless of the number of bystanders. Many studies have observed the effects of volunteerism, as a form of altruism, on happiness and health and have consistently found a strong connection between volunteerism and current and future health and well-being. In a study of older adults, those who volunteered were higher on life satisfaction and will to live, and lower in depression, anxiety, and somatization. Volunteerism and helping behavior have not only been shown to improve mental health, but physical health and longevity as well, attributable to the activity and social integration it encourages. One study examined the physical health of mothers who volunteered over a 30-year period and found that 52% of those who did not belong to a volunteer organization experienced a major illness, while only 36% of those who did volunteer experienced one. A study on adults ages 55 plus found that during the 4-year study period, people who volunteered for two or more organizations had a 63% lower likelihood of dying. After controlling for prior health status, it was determined that volunteerism accounted for a 44% reduction in mortality. Merely being aware of kindness in oneself and others is also associated with greater well-being. A study that asked participants to count each act of kindness they performed for 1 week significantly enhanced their subjective happiness. It is important to note that, while research supports the idea that altruistic acts bring about happiness, it has also been found to work in the opposite direction, that happier people are also kinder. The relationship between altruistic behavior and happiness is bidirectional. Studies have found that generosity increases linearly from sad to happy affective states. Studies have also been careful to note that feeling overtaxed by the needs of others has conversely negative effects on health and happiness. For example, one study on volunteerism found that feeling overwhelmed by others' demands had an even stronger negative effect on mental health than helping had a positive ion, although positive effects were still significant. Additionally, while generous acts make people feel good about themselves, it is also important for people to appreciate the kindness they receive from others. Studies suggest that gratitude goes hand in hand with kindness and is also very important for our well-being. A study on the relationship happiness to various character strengths showed that a conscious focus on gratitude led to reductions in negative effect and increases in optimistic appraisals, positive effect, offering emotional support, sleep quality, and well-being. Sociologists have long been concerned with how to build the good society, altruism, morality, and social solidarity. American Sociological Association. The structure of our societies and how individuals come to exhibit charitable, philanthropic, and other pro-social, altruistic actions for the common good is a largely researched topic within the field. The American Sociology Association, ASA, acknowledges public sociology, saying, "The intrinsic scientific, policy, and public relevance of this field of investigation and helping to construct good societies is unquestionable. Altruism, morality, and social solidarity ASA. This type of sociology seeks contributions that aid grassroots and theoretical understandings of what motivates altruism and how it is organized, and promotes an altruistic focus in order to benefit the world and people it studies. How altruism is framed, organized, carried out, and what motivates it at the group level is an area of focus that sociologists seek to investigate in order to contribute back to the groups it studies and build the good society. The motivation of altruism is also the focus of study. Some publications link the occurrence of moral outrage to the punishment of perpetrators and compensation of victims. Pathological altruism is when altruism is taken to an unhealthy extreme, and either harms the altruistic person, or well-intentioned actions cause more harm than good. The term pathological altruism was popularized by the book Pathological Altruism. Examples include depression and burnout seen in healthcare professionals, an unhealthy focus on others to the detriment of one's own needs, hoarding of animals, and ineffective philanthropic and social programs that ultimately worsen the situations they are meant to aid. Most, if not all, of the world's religions promote altruism as a very important moral value. Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, Jainism, Judaism, and Sikhism, etc., place particular emphasis on altruistic morality. Altruism figures prominently in Buddhism. Love and compassion are components of all forms of Buddhism, and are focused on all beings equally. Love is the wish that all beings be happy, and compassion is the wish that all beings be free from suffering. Many illnesses can be cured by the one medicine of love and compassion. These qualities are the ultimate source of human happiness, and the need for them lies at the very core of our being, Dalai Lama. Still, the notion of altruism is modified in such a worldview, since the belief is that such a practice promotes our own happiness. The more we care for the happiness of others, the greater our own sense of well-being becomes, Dalai Lama. In the context of larger ethical discussions on moral action and judgment, Buddhism is characterized by the belief that negative, unhappy, consequences of our actions derive not from punishment or correction based on moral judgment, but from the law of karma, which functions like a natural law of cause and effect. A simple illustration of such cause and effect is the case of experiencing the effects of what one causes. If one causes suffering, then as a natural consequence one would experience a suffering. If one causes happiness, then as a natural consequence one would experience happiness. The fundamental principles of Jainism revolve around the concept of altruism, not only for humans but for all sentient beings. Jainism preaches the view of ahimsa, to live and let live, thereby not harming sentient beings, i.e. uncompromising reverence for all life. It also considers all living things to be equal. The first Tirthankara, Rishabdev, introduced the concept of altruism for all living beings, from extending knowledge and experience to others to donation, giving oneself up for others, nonviolence and compassion for all living things. Jainism prescribes a path of nonviolence to progress the soul to this ultimate goal. A major characteristic of Jain belief is the emphasis on the consequences of not only physical but also mental behaviors. One's unconquered mind with anger, pride, ego, deceit, greed and uncontrolled sense organs are the powerful enemies of humans. Anger spoils good relations, pride destroys humility, deceit destroys peace and greed destroys everything. Jainism recommends conquering anger by forgiveness, pride by humility, deceit by straightforwardness and greed by contentment. Jains believe that to attain enlightenment and ultimately liberation, one must practice the following ethical principles, major vows, in thought, speech and action. The degree to which these principles are practiced is different for householders and monks. They are the great vows, Mahavrata, are prescribed for monks and limited vows, Anuvrata, are prescribed for householders. The householders are encouraged to practice the above-mentioned five vows. The monks have to observe them very strictly. With consistent practice, it will be possible to overcome the limitations gradually, accelerating the spiritual progress. The principle of nonviolence seeks to minimize karmas which limit the capabilities of the soul. Jainism views every soul as worthy of respect because it has the potential to become Siddha, God in Jainism. Because all living beings possess a soul, great care and awareness is essential in one's actions. Jainism emphasizes the equality of all life, advocating harmlessness towards all, whether the creatures are great or small. This policy extends even to microscopic organisms. Jainism acknowledges that every person has different capabilities and capacities to practice and therefore accepts different levels of compliance for ascetics and householders. Altruism is central to the teachings of Jesus found in the Gospel, especially in the Sermon on the Mount and the Sermon on the Plain. From biblical to medieval Christian traditions, tensions between self-affirmation and other regard were sometimes discussed under the heading of disinterested love, as in the Pauline phrase "love seeks not its own interests." In his book Indoctrination and Self-Deception, Roderick Hindery tries to shed light on these tensions by contrasting them with impostors of authentic self-affirmation and altruism, by analysis of other regard within creative individuation of the self, and by contrasting love for the few with love for the many. Love confirms others in their freedom, shuns propaganda and masks, assures others of its presence, and is ultimately confirmed not by mere declarations from others, but by each person's experience and practice from within. As in practical arts, the presence and meaning of love becomes validated and grasped not by words and reflections alone, but in the making of the connection. St. Thomas Aquinas interprets "you should love your neighbor as yourself" as meaning that love for ourselves is the exemplar of love for others. Considering that the love with which a man loves himself is the form and root of friendship, and quotes Aristotle that the origin of friendly relations with others lies in our relations to ourselves, he concluded that though we are not bound to love others more than ourselves, we naturally seek the common good, the good of the whole, more than any private good, the good of a part. However, he thinks we should love God more than ourselves and our neighbors, and more than our bodily life, since the ultimate purpose of loving our neighbor is to share an eternal beatitude, a more desirable thing than bodily well-being. In coining the word altruism, as stated above, Comte was probably opposing this Thomistic doctrine, which is present in some theological schools within Catholicism. Many biblical authors draw a strong connection between love of others and love of God. 1 John 4 states that for one to love God one must love his fellow man, and that hatred of one's fellow man is the same as hatred of God. Thomas J. Ord has argued in several books that altruism is but one possible form of love. An altruistic action is not always a loving action. Ord defines altruism as acting for the other's good, and he agrees with feminists who note that sometimes love requires acting for one's own good when the other's demands undermine overall well-being. German philosopher Max Scheler distinguishes two ways in which the strong can help the weak. One way is a sincere expression of Christian love, motivated by a powerful feeling of security, strength, and inner salvation, of the invincible fullness of one's own life and existence. Another way is merely one of the many modern substitutes for love. Nothing but the urge to turn away from oneself and to lose oneself in other people's business. At its worst, Scheler says, love for the small, the poor, the weak, and the oppressed is really disguised hatred, repressed envy, an impulse to detract, etc., directed against the opposite phenomena, wealth, strength, power, largesse. In Islam, the concept ithar, altruism, is the notion of preferring others to oneself. For Sufis, this means devotion to others through complete forgetfulness of one's own concerns, where concern for others is rooted to be a demand made by Allah on the human body, considered to be property of Allah alone. The importance lies in sacrifice for the sake of the greater good. Islam considers those practicing are as abiding by the highest degree of nobility. This is similar to the notion of chivalry, but unlike that European concept, in Ithar attention is focused on everything in existence. A constant concern for Allah, i.e. God, results in a careful attitude towards people, animals, and other things in this world. This concept was emphasized by Sufis of Islam like Rabia al-Adawiyya, who paid attention to the difference between dedication to Allah, i.e. God, and dedication to people. 13th century Turkish Sufi poet Yunus Emre explained this philosophy as yaratlan severis, yaratandan aturu, or we love the creature, because of the creator. For many Muslims, idhar must be practiced as a religious obligation during specific Islamic holidays. However, idhar is also still an Islamic ideal to which all Muslims should strive to adhere at all times. Judaism defines altruism as the desired goal of creation. The famous Rabbi Abraham Isaac Kook stated that love is the most important attribute in humanity. This is defined as bestowal, or giving, which is the intention of altruism. This can be altruism towards humanity that leads to altruism towards the Creator or God. Kabbalah defines God as the force of giving in existence. Rabbi Moshe Chaim Luzzatto in particular focused on the purpose of creation and how the will of God was to bring creation into perfection and adhesion with this upper force. Modern Kabbalah developed by Rabbi Yehuda Ashlag, in his writings about the future generation, focuses on how society could achieve an altruistic social framework. Ashlag proposed that such a framework is the purpose of creation, and everything that happens is to raise humanity to the level of altruism, love for one another. Ashlag focused on society and its relation to divinity. Altruism is essential to the Sikh religion. The central faith in Sikhism is that the greatest deed anyone can do is to imbibe and live the godly qualities like love, affection, sacrifice, patience, harmony, truthfulness. The fifth Nanak, Guru Arjan Dev, sacrificed his life to uphold 22 carats of pure truth, the greatest gift to humanity, the Guru Granth. The ninth Guru, Tegh Bahadur, sacrificed his head to protect weak and defenseless people against atrocity. In the late 17th century, Guru Gobind Singh Ji, the 10th Guru in Sikhism, was in war with the Mughal rulers to protect the people of different faiths when a fellow Sikh, Bhai Kanhia, attended the troops of the enemy. He gave water to both friends and foes who were wounded on the battlefield. Some of the enemy began to fight again and some Sikh warriors were annoyed by Bhai Kanhia as he was helping their enemy. Sikh soldiers brought Bhai Kanhia before Guru Gobind Singh Ji, and complained of his action that they considered counterproductive to their struggle on the battlefield. "What were you doing, and why?" asked the Guru. "I was giving water to the wounded because I saw your face and all of them," replied Bhai Kanhia. The Guru responded, "Then you should also give them ointment to heal their wounds. You were practicing what you were coached in the house of the Guru." It was under the tutelage of the Guru that Bhai Kanhia subsequently founded a volunteer corps for altruism. This volunteer corps still to date is engaged in doing good to others and trains new volunteering recruits for doing the same. In Hinduism, selflessness, atmayog, love, prema, kindness, daya, and forgiveness, kshama, are considered as the highest acts of humanity or manusaiva. Giving alms to the beggars or poor people is considered as a divine act or punya, and Hindus believe it will free their souls from guilt or papa and will lead them to heaven or swarga in afterlife. Altruism is also the central act of various Hindu mythology and religious poems and songs. Swami Vivekananda, the legendary Hindu monk, has said, "Jive prem kare tijon, si jon sabhi chayaswar," whoever loves any living being, is serving God. Mass donation of clothes to poor people, vastraseva, or blood donation camp or mass food donation, anasiva, for poor people is common in various Hindu religious ceremonies. Swami Sivananda, an Advaita scholar, reiterates the views in his commentary synthesizing Vedanta views on the Brahma Sutras, a Vedantic text. In his commentary on Chapter 3 of the Brahma Sutras, Sivananda notes that karma is insentient and short-lived, and ceases to exist as soon as a deed is executed. Hence, karma cannot bestow the fruits of actions at a future date according to one's merit. Furthermore, one cannot argue that karma generates apurva or punya, which gives fruit. Since apurva is non-sentient, it cannot act unless moved by an intelligent being such as a god. It cannot independently bestow reward or punishment. However, the very well-known and popular text, the Bhagavad Gita, supports the doctrine of karma yoga, achieving oneness with God through action, and nishkama karma, or action without expectation, desire for personal gain, which can be said to encompass altruism. Altruistic acts are generally celebrated and very well received in Hindu literature and is central to Hindu morality. There exists a wide range of philosophical views on humans' obligations or motivations to act altruistically. Proponents of ethical altruism maintain that individuals are morally obligated to act altruistically. The opposing view is ethical egoism, which maintains that moral agents should always act in their own self-interest. Both ethical altruism and ethical egoism contrast with utilitarianism, which maintains that each agent should act in order to maximize the efficacy of their function and the benefit of both themselves and their co-inhabitants. A related concept in descriptive ethics is psychological egoism, the thesis that humans always act in their own self-interest and that true altruism is impossible. Rational egoism is the view that rationality consists in acting in one's self-interest, without specifying how this affects one's moral obligations. The genes OXTR, CD38, COMT, DRD4, DRD5, IGF2, GAPRB2 have been found to be candidate genes for altruism. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.